الحمد لله، نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره، ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله، وخير الحج حج محمد، وخير الحج حج محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وخير الحج حج محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدث بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. Another jalsa of sitting with our believing sisters. We wanted this, these lectures to be of many benefits in many ways, بإذن الله تعالى. We initially were saying that we would call it fatawa for the believing sisters, so that the believing sisters also would be aware of things that were of specific need to them, such as the proper character that the Muslim sister must have, the akhlaq al-fadila, the good character, the adab al-shara'iyya, the manners that have been legislated, from hishma, modesty, shyness, and those qualities that have been stressed in Quran and Sunnah and implemented and shown in the lives of the women companions, radiyallahu anhunna. And to know that Islam, that Allah Ta'ala revealed from the heavens, has generations and generations and generations of great Muslim women scholars, great Muslim women worshippers, great Muslim women teachers, and great Muslim women who have called to Islam and served Islam. And this is very important to understand, because some people think, or because of the lack of mentioning all of these great women, that they don't exist. And in fact, they do exist, and they should be a guide for the believing woman. The believing woman should have her as her guide and have as her example such women that have been mentioned in Quran and in Sunnah and throughout the history of Islam, like Maryam, the mother of Isa alayhi salam, and Asiya, the wife of Fir'aun, and many other righteous women, and from the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, like Khadija and Fatima, Khadija and his daughter Fatima, and his wife Aisha, and all the rest of the believing women. These should be the example. And the many women scholars, alhamdulillah, there have been nowadays, alhamdulillah, there are translations for those who don't have a grasp of the Arabic language. And my nasiha to the sisters would be for them to strive, for our Muslim sisters to strive in seeking the Arabic language, in learning the Arabic language. For wallahi azeem, it is the tool by which you gain, or the key through which you gain access to the words of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala and to the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and into the lives of the women of the, or as we call them, the sahabiyat. Alhamdulillah, Tabaqat ibn Sa'd, one volume of it dealing with the Muslim women of Medina has been translated. But this is like taking a needle and dipping it in the ocean and bringing back that piece of water or that mount of water that is stuck in the eye of the needle. It is very, very small amount of what is available. Today, and maybe we will do this if we can, as often as we can, and we hope that this will not be the last time we will do something of this nature, we want to deal with the fada'il, the merits of certain Muslim women, great Muslim women, from the book of fada'il in the Sahih of Imam Muslim, which is volume 4, and basically begins at page 1296, starting with Khadija radiyallahu anha. We'll be using the explanation of this book, inshaAllah ta'ala. The book Fada'il al-Sahaba is the title that Imam Muslim, actually the title that was given to it, either by Imam Muslim or by Imam Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala. And it speaks about many of the women of the Sahabiyat, many of the Sahabiyat. For instance, it talks about the virtues of Khadija, Umm al-Mu'mineen, radiyallahu anha, the merits of Khadija, the merits of Aisha, radiyallahu ta'ala anha. It mentions the hadith of Zara, which is a well-known long hadith, in which the women sit around and all of them describe their husbands and certain qualities that their husbands possess. The merits of Fatima, the daughter of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The merits of Salama, the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The merits of Ayman, the merits of Sulaim, who is the mother of Anas ibn Malik, radiyallahu anha wa radiyallahu anhu. And the merits of the women of the Quraysh, the women of the Quraysh, radiyallahu anhunna. All of these are narrations, and you can find similar in the Sahih of Imam Bukhari, speaking about some of the merits and some of the stories of these great women. We must be grateful to Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala that He has guided us to Islam. And we must be grateful to Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala that He has given us great examples, and all we need do is follow them, to try our best to be like them. It is very important that the mu'minat, the believing women, start to have high goals, in the sense that they start to want, and not saying that there's not amongst them those who do, but in general, that they start to want to be like the women at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the righteous women of that time, and the righteous women of every age that have followed in the footsteps of those great believing women. And that the believing woman stops feeling discouraged at what she sees around her, or the atmosphere that she is living in. and not to look at her peers or those who are living in this time with her, because that could lead to discouragement. That could lead to her being discouraged, rather. Rather, she should look to the generation of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the righteous women that were at his time and that have been around since for the generations of Islam up to this day. If this is done, then it won't be said, well, I'm doing this, but sister such and such is not doing this. I'm acting upon this particular aspect of Sharia, but sister such and such is not acting upon this. And if the goals are lofty and the goals are high, and if one is striving for the Jannah, and most importantly, the pleasure of Allah, Tabaraka wa ta'ala, then we must look at the women that Allah Tabaraka wa ta'ala has been pleased with. There's a narration in which Abdullah bin Ja'far brings it, that he heard Ali say in Kufa, Ali bin Ali ibn Abi Talib, radiyallahu anhu, the cousin of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his son-in-law, the one who married his daughter Fatima radiyallahu anha, that Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the best of the women of her time was Maryam, daughter of Imran, and the best of the women of her time was Khadija, daughter of Khuwaylid, and Abu Qurayb, the narrator, said that Waqi', when he was narrating this hadith, pointed towards the sky and the earth. Yani, the best women in the heavens and the earth at her particular time. Because Waqi starts pointing to the heavens and the earth. Huh? And Khadija bin Khuwaylid. Another narration of Abu Musa radiyallahu anhu, who says, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, there are many persons amongst men who are quite perfect, meaning they have reached total manhood. They have completed, what they mean is completed their manhood. But there are not many women who have reached that except Maryam bint Imran, the mother of Isa radiallahu anha alayhi salam, Asiya, the wife of Fir'aun, and the Prophet ﷺ didn't say it, Aisha, as compared to women, is like that of Thareed over all other foods, which is one of the dishes that the Prophet ﷺ preferred, consisting of very thin bread soaked in a broth of meat and sometimes vegetables. So this was the best food, and she was like that amongst the women. And these women have reached the best level of being believing women, and they have pleased Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is some of the fada'il, or the virtues, of these women. When Waqi said that, he pointed to the heavens and the earth. When he said the best of the women of her time was Maryam bint Imran, he pointed to the heavens and to the earth. And when he said the best of the women of her time was Khadija bint Khuwaylid radiallahu anha, and he pointed to the heavens and to the earth, meaning they were the best women at their time, whether in the heavens or on earth. رضي الله عنهن رضي الله عنهن. ها نو آسيا يا آسيا is a wife of Fir'aun. That's the second hadith. Khadija, of course, is the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he mentions here that the Prophet's marriage with Khadija took place about 15 years before he became a messenger. He was 25 and she was 40 years old. She was a rich widow and she ran a large trade of her own. It was she who offered herself in marriage to the Prophet when she had sent her slave to travel with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he saw the excellent qualities and characteristics that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had, and he said, you know, this is the man. He mentioned it to her, and she then became interested in marrying the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a merchant for her. He worked for her as a trader at one period of time. It says, from the time of the marriage to her death, the Prophet ﷺ loved her more than anyone else. And he never married anyone else while she was alive. And that was a period of 20 years. And she gave him ease in all of his circumstances and had deep love and devotion. رضي الله عنها خديجة بنت خويلد. خديجة بنت خويلد. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam received revelation, the first time he received revelation in the cave of Hira, he ran to her, and she wrapped him up and spoke to him, kindly, and moved. Pushed away his fears. He was fearing that there's something wrong maybe with him. So she was telling him, no, Allah Ta'ala would never abandon you, would never mistreat you. You keep good kith and kin. You help those in need. So she was saying, she was letting him know not to worry about any harm or any problems or difficulties or Allah Ta'ala forsaking him or anything of that nature because he had those good characters and characteristics and qualities that good comes to those type of people usually. Okay. Imam Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala says, about this narration, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, Khayr al-Nisa'iha, the best women are Maryam bin Imran, best Nisa'iha, the Nisa'iha meaning at that time. وخير نسائها خديجة بنت خويلد. And Waqi'a pointed to the heavens and the earth. Waqi'a meant to point out by this action of his that it meant all of the women of the earth, all of the women between the heavens and the earth, that they are the best women at their time. In that regard, they are the best women at that time of the women of the earth. Then the statement that many men have been completed or have reached completion or perfection within their manhood, and they have reached a complete status that they want, that Allah Ta'ala wants the people to have or to reach. But the women, From the women, not many have reached that, except Maryam bint Imran, wa Asiya, the wife of Fir'aun. He explains here that this narration is pointing to the fact of their virtues or their fada'il of these particular women. That out of all the women on the earth, that there are some who complete or reach a level of perfection in their womanhood, and there are, but the vast majority do not. And that these women, amongst their merits, is that they in fact have. Is that they in fact have. And the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that the situation of Aisha, as he translates it here, excellence of Aisha as compared to women is that of a thareed. So the scholars have said that a thareed from every type of food is the best type. A thareed of every type of food is the best type. So what he is saying here is that amongst the women, Aisha radiallahu anha has qualities and characteristics that make her better than other women. Make her better than other women. Then he brings a hadith of Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu. And this is a great hadith. This is a great hadith. Because we're still dealing with the chapter of the merits of Khadija radiallahu anha. First hadith said that she was the best woman of her time, whether in heavens or on earth. Second hadith said that she had completed and perfected her womanhood. Among women, she was perfect and complete in this regard in her the area of being a woman. Because no one is perfect but Allah Ta'ala, means that she completed. She reached the level of completion and perfection in her womanhood. The third hadith, the hadith on Azim, a great hadith. Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu reported that Jibril alayhi salam, the angel that brought the revelation from Allah Ta'ala and placed it upon the heart of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, came to Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, Ya Rasulullah, look, Khadija is coming to you with a vessel of seasoned food or drink. When she comes to you, offer her greetings from her Lord, the Exalted and Glorious. And on my behalf, offer her greetings from her Lord. And on my behalf, greetings from Jibril also. And give her glad tidings of a palace of jewels in paradise, wherein there is no noise and no toil. No noise and no labor. This is on the authority of Abu Hurairah. And in Arabic it says basically the same thing. She's coming to you awwalan. She comes to you, say to her faqra alayha salam, give her salam. Salam from who? Salam from the Lord of the heavens and the earth and all that is between them. Salam from her Lord, subhanahu wa ta'ala. If there was no other virtue than this, it would be enough. If there was no other merit than this, it would be enough. If there was no other quality which would make all the women of the earth want to be just like Khadija bint Khuwaylid radiallahu anha, this would be enough. That her Lord sent the angel Jibril to relay to her salam from him. Salam from him. And salam is a dua. The one giving the salam is the same one who answers the dua. And then Jibril says, and give her salam for me also. Khadija bin Khuwaylid, radiyallahu anha wardaha, we could talk about her after sitting, or jalsa after jalsa after jalsa, in dars. We could do doctoral theses about her life and in detail. Look at the quality that she possesses. No doubt that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was and is the most beloved person to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. And that Khadija bint Khuwaylid was the most beloved to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam in his lifetime. This was recognized by Aisha radiyallahu anha, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, after the passing away of Khadija, loved no one more on earth than Aisha, her father, and then her. Her father from amongst men and her from amongst women. But even when he would mention Khadija radiyallahu anha, his eyes would water. Shah radiyallahu anha would become jealous of that. And there's a narration to this effect in Sahih Bukhari. And she pampered the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, comforted the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the most severest times, when the whole world was astray and in darkness, and that the light was given to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, she was there to comfort him. So this is a woman of great character and great qualities. This is a woman that every believing woman, man or child, man, woman or child, should know something about. This is the type of woman, radiyallahu anha wa ardaha, and our mother, because she's the mother, our first mother, because the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are mothers of the believers, Ummul Mu'mineen. And this is one of the reasons they weren't allowed to marry them, because they are considered their mothers. Khadija radiyallahu anha wa ardaha, her life should be studied, and her name should be a name that is on the tongues of the children, and she should be a hero from the women, and they must know about her, so that her name is not something strange, and that when they hear it, they say radiyallahu anha upon her with a heart full of love and a heart full of longing to meet her in the Jannah, and wanting to be like her in this world. This is very important. So that they start to look away and turn away outwardly and inwardly from the mutabarrijat, the women who uncover themselves, the khawajat, the westernized women, the women who don't raise their head to Kitab, to the Book of Allah, or to the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The women who aren't concerned with what Allah tabarakallah wants them to do or tells them to do in his book, or aren't concerned with what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said about the women or the women to do in Sunnah, and aren't concerned about the lives of the great women of Islam. A greeting from the Lord of the Worlds. A greeting from the Lord of the Worlds, sent special delivery by Jibreel radiyallahu anhu wa alayhi salam. And look at the quality here, that she was bringing the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam something to eat or drink. She was establishing her obligations to her husband, who by the grace of Allah Ta'ala happens to be the messenger of Allah, salawatullahi wa salam alayhi. No, we must know that Allah Ta'ala says in Surah An-Nur, the meaning of verse, that good men are for good women, and good women are for good men, and bad men are for bad women, and bad women are for bad men. Imam Shafi, radiallahu anhu, the great Imam, said this here proves that anyone who tries to say anything negative in the slightest way about the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they are in fact saying something negative about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because good women are for good men are for good women. So the fact that Allah Ta'ala chose these particular women to be the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam shows that they are the best women in their beliefs and in their character and in their way of living. There's no doubt about that. It is no doubt about that. That since good men are for good women and good women are for good men, that the best man upon earth is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then there's no doubt that the best woman on earth is his wife. There's no doubt about that. And unfortunately, there are groups who try to find fault with the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and in particular Aisha radiallahu anha. And we will deal with that, inshallah ta'ala, in the future. Inshallah ta'ala, in the future lecture, inshallah. But what we want to benefit more than anything else and understand is that these are the women who have to be mentioned in our household. That before our children know actresses, if they should know them at all, or soap opera stars, and we hope that they don't know them at all, or singers from amongst women, or anything of that nature, that they know these great women. That Khadija bin Khuwaylid radiyallahu anha becomes a household name. She becomes a household name. And that they know her virtues. And that maybe the energetic ones amongst us, the ones who are rushing to the obedience of Allah Ta'ala and to following the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and to placing our households upon the minhaj of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his companions, that we will make sure that our young daughters or young sisters or young nieces memorize a couple of hadith connected with Khadija bin Khuwaylid radiallahu anha, a couple hadith connected to Aisha radiallahu anha, a couple of hadith connected to Fatima. Know something about her life, know something about her, and that the parents and murabbeen or the teachers or counselors, whoever has any type of influence upon the young hearts and minds, that they plant the seed of love for these great women. Love, respect, a wanting to emulate and be like these women has to be there. Like I said, to Khadija bin Khuwaylid radiallahu anha becomes a household name. The narration says, that it is salam from the Lord of the worlds and from Jibreel alayhi salam, and a house or palace of jewels in paradise. Glad tidings of a palace of jewels in paradise. In order to get the palace, and it's in paradise, means you have to enter paradise. So it's bushra upon bushra upon bushra. Glad tidings upon glad tidings upon glad tidings. Salam from Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Peace from Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. The one who can protect one from all harm. The one who can give without even giving any account. Without any account, without calculating, the provider, the one who gives generously, the all-loving, the all-merciful, he sends her salam, she will be in total salam. And on top of that, Jannah and a palace of jewels, of precious diamonds and gems, that not like the jewelry of this dunya, of this low dunya, this small dunya, of which, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if Allah cared anything about it, if He cared as much as a wing of a mosquito about it, He would not have given the kafir a drink of water from it. No, we're talking about a jannah that Allah tabarak ta'ala prepared with his hands. Built with His hands. And when Allah tabarak ta'ala prepares something, there's no preparation compared to it. Where Allah tabarak ta'ala put the choice, the things that He chooses, the things that He know will bring bliss and enjoyment and serenity and relaxation and happiness to the servants that He placed there. Not for a day or two, but forever. A Jannah, a place that every second or blink of an eye, or less than that, there is something that astonishes and amazes and pleases and brings about joy and happiness in the hearts of the believers while they're there. May Allah mix us amongst them. So she was giving bushra of this Jannah and a palace of jewels in paradise. Qasab. The majority of scholars say a qasab here means a big pearl. A palace made out of a big pearl. And some say, made out of dhahab, gold. Ala kulli halin, this is a great blessing. And it shows the love of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala for this great woman. It shows that. And it also shows what it says, wherein there is no noise and no toil. Wherein there is no noise or no toil. She doesn't have to worry about noise, nor does she have to worry about labor. The khidmah and the service that she has done for the pleasure of Allah tabarak ta'ala in this world, she has been rewarded for in totality and given more than, of course, the action. Because Allah tabarak ta'ala is generous and He gives without counting. Khadija bint Khuwaylid radiyallahu anha wa ardaha. There's another narration here, which is quite similar, actually it's the same, but sometimes this is, we get benefit from the repetition of the narrations. Ismail reported, I said to Abdullah ibn Abi Awfa, did Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam give glad tidings of paradise to Khadija? He said, yes, he did give glad tidings to her of a palace of jewels in paradise, wherein there would be no noise and no toil. Aisha radiallahu anha reported, never did I feel jealous of any woman as I was jealous of Khadija. She had died 3 years before he, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, married me. I often heard him praise her, and his Lord ordered him to give her the glad tidings of a palace of jewels in paradise. And whenever the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam slaughtered a sheep, he presented its meat to some the female friends of Khadija, her friends that were still alive. So Aisha radiallahu anha says she felt jealous about Khadija radiallahu anha. Aisha radiallahu anha. And she also informs us that the Prophet ﷺ for 3 years between the marriage from Khadija to her was 3 years. And then whenever the Prophet ﷺ mentioned her, he praised her and gave her compliments. And that when he slaughtered sheep, he thought of her friends. So it means that Khadija was never far from his mind and his heart. Alayhi salam. Aisha radiallahu anha says another narration. Never did I feel jealous of the wives of Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But in case of Khadija, although I did not have the privilege to see her, and in the case of her, I felt jealous. She further said that whenever Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam slaughtered a sheep, he said, send it to the companions of Khadija. I annoyed him one day and said, it is Khadija only who always prevails upon your mind. It is only Khadija that you think about, yani. Thereupon Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, her love had been nurtured in my heart by Allah himself. Her love has been nurtured in my heart, Ya Aisha. O kama qala Islam. Her love has been nurtured in my heart by Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala himself. Khair inshallah, go ahead. You have a question, right? Go ahead. I don't see anything present here, but yes, there are descriptions given of the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But I have nothing present at the present moment. But like I said, subhanallah, this knowledge now that has been translated is very good, so that the sisters can get some source from it. You know, can get some knowledge from, I mean, as a source, can use it as a source of knowledge. But there's much, much more. There's so much, much more out there that can be acquired, or that can be, you know, the knowledge about them. And it should become something that is commonplace within the home, that we discuss and talk about these great Muslim women. Because it is very, very bad if you mention Khadija bin Khuwaylid and they don't recognize who you're talking about. Or you say Safiya and they don't know who you mean. Or you say Zayna or Sauda, or, you know, so on and so forth. All the Sahabiyat. Or you say Umayma. No. Who's Umayma? You don't know. And these books are there. It's not like it's something far-fetched. I mean, Sahih Muslim is available. Sahih Bukhari is available, the other books are available, and books like the wives of the women of Medina rather, and books like the Sahabiyat, and there are more books, alhamdulillah, that are coming constantly. These are to be utilized. And once again, you know, I reiterate and I say that the young sisters should memorize these narrations. Brothers also, don't get me wrong, the brothers should know also. But they need a qudwa. They need an example. And they need people that they know that they should emulate and be like. I mean, for one, you're in Darul Kufr. You're in the land of the Kufar. And dressing in a manner that the sisters dress based on the fact that they are obeying Allah Ta'ala and obeying the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is sometimes very, very difficult. Very, very difficult. Alhamdulillah, as long as they know what the greater difficult, they get the greater reward. But they must understand, and when looking at the lives of the companions, women of the companions, that some of the things that they went through, they must know about Sumayya radiallahu anha, the first one to die in the path of Allah Ta'ala. I wasn't a man. The first one killed in the path of Allah Ta'ala was Sumayya. Should not Sumayya's name be a household name? Should not Sumayya's name, radiallahu anha, be someone that is talked about, someone that is looked up to, someone that is emulated? Should they not know that there was a disagreement and that a woman came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam complaining about her husband, and that Allah ta'ala heard her and sent down verses dealing with the issue? And Aisha radiallahu anha said, I was in the... humble youth or houses or apartments that lined or circled the masjid. She said, I'm there and I didn't hear her complaining. But Allah tabarak ta'ala complained her. And her name was Khawla bin Thaliba. Now should not, do you know about Khawla? Amongst the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there's one that Allah ta'ala married the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to her. That the marriage took place that Allah ta'ala married the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to her. Everybody else, their awliya, their walis married them. But this one, Allah ta'ala married her to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Who's that woman? What's her name? Amongst the women of the Sahaba radiallahu anhu was the woman who made two hijras, two migrations. Who is it? What's her name? These are the women of the Sahaba and the fada'il, or the merits of these women. And they must be the examples that the children, and especially the young girls, look up to and know. This is the only thing that's going to benefit them in this life and hereafter. It's not going to benefit them knowing some khawajat, some singer or some actress or some model. They should know that these are mutabarrijat. These are women who have uncovered themselves and have displeased Allah tabarak ta'ala and are awaiting His wrath at the same time that their own misguidance and are possibly experiencing His wrath at this moment, but aren't aware of it. And it is stated that the worst punishment is a punishment that you're not aware to be punished at the time that you're not aware that you're being punished. They should be taught not to have any type of belief within the kuffar women. But these are women who, if they want to help them and cure them of their illnesses, they must give them da'wah to the guidance of Allah Ta'ala. They must be told that Islam has placed women in such a position that no other deen, in no other community, no other way of life, no other anything has given them that position and those rights that Islam has given them. And that Allah Ta'ala, in His infinite wisdom and mercy and love, has shown His concern and His love for the Muslim women by the legislation that He has sent down from the heavens. And all they need do is follow it. The women of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum and those who follow them righteously must become the source of bringing about some enthusiasm for Islam. There must be amongst the Muslim girls who say, I want to be like Khadija bin Khuwaylid. One that say, I want to be like Aisha. One say, I want to be like Hafsa. One who says, I want to be like Asiya, the wife of Fir'aun, and also the daughter of Fir'aun, who rejected the deen of her father, which is to worship him, and it was on the deen of her mother, who he tore apart into pieces, Fir'aun. This narration has been mentioned. These are the women who are the heroes and are the guides. Can you imagine living in the house of someone who thinks they're God? Who said, Ana Rabbukum al-A'la, I am your God, your Lord. And she maintained her belief and maintained her taqwa and maintained her trust and would make dua to Allah to tell, oh Allah, build me a house with you in the paradise. And her dua was answered. Maryam radiallahu anha should be an example. Maryam bint Imran, who had trust in Allah tabarak ta'ala, who conceived by the permission of Allah tabarak ta'ala, kun fakana Isa, be, and Isa was. Given the amount of distrust, the amount of disrespect that she had to endure, being an unwed mother, they said, Ya Ukhta Harun, what is this? You know, your mother wasn't somebody who was a fornicator or adulterer. What you doing pregnant? What are you doing with this baby? Because at that time she had given birth to him. She left it to Isa to speak, and he spoke. These women must be the example. These women, their names must be mentioned in the house. Their life story should be known. Wallahi azeem. Wallahi, by Allah, the one who created the heavens and the earth and all that is between them, if they know more about the kuffar and know more about their lives, and their eyes are widened and the expressions are brought to life, and joy is on their face when these kuffar names are mentioned, then Allahu Akbar, it is our fault, and Allah tabaraka ta'ala will call us to account. Allah tabaraka ta'ala, wallahi azeem, wallahi alladhi la ilaha illa huwa, by Allah, who there's no one in existence that has a right to be worshipped but him, we will be the blame. How did she know Janet Jackson but didn't know Khadija bin Khuwaylid? How did she know Madonna and didn't know Maryam bin Imran? Haki, subhanAllah. So this insanity that is being lived amongst the Muslims, who say that they want the izzah, the power, and the return of the Islamic rulership of the world, and we don't even have that in our house. Like one of the du'at said, establish Islam in your heart, Allah Ta'ala will establish it on earth for you. Establish Islam in your bait, you'll see it in the community and in the world. And this is the responsibility of both parents. No doubt about it. But no doubt that if the man is outside of the house constantly trying to achieve a halal living and provide for the family, that the hadith that we didn't take here, that the best women of the women of Quraysh stated that one of the reasons because they could fulfill the rights of their husbands as well as show kindness and gentleness and concern for the rearing and raising of the children. There's no doubt that we said in our earlier lecture, the mother is the first madrasa. She's the first school. And if she's a good school, those who come out of that school are the best people. And this is very serious. And it's very important. And there's nothing like recognizing the truth of an issue, making tawbah to Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, and have resolve to change that situation, and to place in the minds and the hearts of our young Muslim women or future women that these are the women who we look to. These are the women who we look to. They must have within them a dislike and disdain for the women of the kuffar, and a dislike and disdain for women who display characteristics that are other than the characteristics of the great women companions, the Sahabiyat radiallahu anhunna. If we succeed in Khadija bint Khuwaylid and Aisha bint Abi Bakr and Sumayya, Khawla bint Thaliba, and on and on and on, and Asiya, Imra'at Fir'aun, Maryam bint Imran, if they become the heroes in the household, and they become the ones that are emulated, if we succeed in that, then inshallah ta'ala, we can say that we have fulfilled our obligation of being parents, or counselors, or teachers, or people who have influence upon the young lives that we have influence upon. In the future, inshallah ta'ala, we're trying to make a more detailed discussion of these ahadith, and more detailed discussion of certain issues and situations that took place in the lives of these great women. And inshallah ta'ala, this will be part of what we will be calling a sitting, or a sitting with the believing women, inshallah ta'ala. If there's any questions, send them up. Hada wa sallallahu ala Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Okay, faddal. If someone wants to bring the answer about the woman who Allah Ta'ala married to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, that would be nice, and we can deal with it the next. I'm not going to be relating who. Suffice it to say that it wasn't Aisha. Okay. And you can bring it inshallah ta'ala at the next Jalsa Ma'a Mu'minat inshallah. I was talking about the discouragement among sisters due to the outside forces or inside forces. Which one was I talking about? I'm speaking about both. Because sometimes, and Abu Raisa mentioned this, Jamal al-Din, in one lecture, that he, and it's something that people see, that sometimes a sister, the ones that can hurt you or give you discouragement or the most, are the ones who you come in contact with. The sister who's covering and telling you that you're covering too much. The sister who's telling you that you should go out and work and get a Western education, these type of things, and discourage your actions that you are doing. These are, wallahi alim, by Allah ta'ala, these are not women who are giving sisters correct advice. They are not giving nasiha. They would not be able to come and say, I'm giving her nasiha because I'm trying to please Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. No, this would not be the case. She should tell the sister, which is just to do if she's confronted with the sister in outside community like this, she should tell the sister, fear Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. Fear Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. And explain to her that I am trying to be like the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the companions and the righteous women. This is what she should explain to her, and that you should be about the same purpose, because anything else is a waste of time. And we have enough, subhanAllah, of the women who want to disobey Allah Ta'ala or want to live on the fence between Western ideas and Islamic ideas, between Western practices and Islamic practices, between Western viewpoints and Islamic viewpoints. There's no fence city. It has to be on one side or the other. There's nothing else. You can't be from the Hizbullah, the group of Allah, the party of Allah. Well, hum al-ghalibun, they will be the successful ones. And in fact, they have already succeeded, because Allah said, "Qad aflaha al-mu'minun." The believers have succeeded, in past tense. And from the Hizb al-Shaytan. You can't be on the path to Jannah and at the same time on the path to hellfire. Can't take as your example Fatima bint Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Khadija bint Khuwaylid and Aisha bint Abi Bakr radiyallahu anhunna, and at the same time have Dr. such and such and these actresses and soap opera stars and models and so on and so forth also as example. No, it's no middle course. It has to be mufasala, total separation. It has to be within the hearts of the sister of thiqqa, of sincere, truthful love and trust in Allah Ta'ala, that Allah Ta'ala has blessed them with this Islam, has blessed them with Iman, has blessed them with this Quran, has blessed them with the Sunnah and of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and has blessed them with generations and generations and generations of Muslim women who have stood upon this earth by the grace of Allah and worship Allah Ta'ala until death came to them, and therefore achieve the pleasure of Allah Ta'ala in His paradise, that this should be and must be her goal also. This should be and must be her goal also. Leaving the ideas and the viewpoints and the manners and methods and ways of the mushrik women. For wallahi azeem, is nothing but poison. It's nothing but poison. It's nothing but venom. It's nothing but something that will take you away from the book of Allah tabarak ta'ala, and from the sunnah of the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and from Islam. There's no doubt about that. And if there's an inkling of the doubt, then the sister must stand up in the middle of the night, at the third of the night, when Allah tabarak ta'ala comes down to the heavens of the dunya and says, "Who asks so that I may grant them? Who wants forgiveness so that I may forgive him?" And to Fajr. And using also the sajda, the dua and sajda, asking Allah Ta'ala to heal her of shukuk, doubts. Doubts. There must not be any doubt nor hesitation. Wallahi, walillahi alhamd. The sisters are on the path to Jannah, but it is a matter of being patient and having resolve and achieving some certainty. And inshallah ta'ala, the believers will be pleased after a while. Khair. No, we could discuss the Hadith al-Muzara'at sometime in the future. I think some brothers have dealt with it. I think There's some tapes out of brothers dealing with it. But it basically was a discussion of those long hadith where they said, and some said, well, my husband's like a lion, and he's like this and that and the other, you know, giving examples of what their husband was like. And it's not a bad thing, no. They didn't mean it in a... Okay. What was discussed amongst the women, and mashallah, eventually, of course, Aisha radiallahu anha related to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But it can be looked into. It can be looked into. The question was sitting around the hadith of Zara'a and the discussion of them of the women discussing their husbands. But inshallah ta'ala, we hope and we pray that Allah tabarak ta'ala guide the Muslims to implement Islam totally in their lives, I mean, and that we make the salihat, righteous women, qanitat, women who obey Allah tabarak ta'ala, sa'imat, women who fast for the pleasure of Allah tabarak ta'ala, dhakirat Allah kathiran, those who remember Allah a lot, Hafidat lifarujihinna, those who guard their modesty. We ask Allah Ta'ala to make our women like those that I've mentioned in Quran. And anything that will help or bring this about, then we should all be, our ears and our hearts should be open to it. Because it's really time for all hands to be on deck. You know, the ship that this ummah is on, waves are knocking at it from all sides. And was it not by the grace and pleasure of Allah Ta'ala, we would have sunk a long time ago. It is discouraging and saddening that the lives of these great women are in books and not on our tongues, our own pages, and not in our hearts. This is something to be shamed, to be ashamed of, actually. Because when they have their proper position as being our guides and being the ones that we're trying to be like, and being the ones, because Allah Ta'ala was pleased with them, and we don't know if He's pleased with us or not, but we know He was pleased with them. So if we want to please Allah Ta'ala, then we have to act and be like the ones whom He was pleased with. And this starts in the home first and foremost. And you see a lot of times there's an issue of tarbiyah or raising or properly raising and introducing these matters to children in general. But to me there seems to be an awful lot of laxity on the part of giving this information and raising Muslim girls upon this type of thing. For some reason, I don't know what the reasons are. You know. And all we have to do, subhanAllah, is look through recent history. Many girls who were covering when they were very young are not covering anymore now. Their hearts and their ideas and their viewpoints were going in a different direction. And while they were under the care of their parents, then they were one way. And now that they were free to do whatever they want to do, they did something else. We hope that Allah Ta'ala protect us from repeating such types of history.
Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salam ala rasulillah. The proceeding has been a presentation of Al-Maktabatu Salafiyya and SalafiBookstore.com. We are a registered charitable non-profit organization located in the United Kingdom, which promotes Islamic da'wah through various platforms, including the Salafi Masjid and Islamic Center located in Birmingham, UK, our full and part-time Islamic school, our Islamic websites and affiliates such as Salaf.com, SalafiPublications.com, TheNobleQuran.com, and our other numerous websites, our Islamic seminars, classes, lectures, and events, are non-Muslim and media outreach programs towards promoting positive understanding of Islam and numerous other charitable Islamic projects. You may contact us online at www.salafipublications.com. You may order products at www.salafibookstore.com. You may email us at inquiries@salafipublications.com. For order inquiries, at orders@salafibookstore.com. You may reach us by phone at 0121-773-0003. By fax at 0121-773-4882. And in person or by mail at Salafi Bookstore and Islamic Center, 472 Coventry Road, Small Heath, Birmingham, West Midlands, United Kingdom, B100UG. وجزاكم الله خير وبارك الله فيكم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.